So we are addressing jealousy this week in a little bit more detail than we concluded last week. Last week we spent a lot of time on anger, correct? Please jog my memory. What did I touch jealousy last week?
Very briefly.
I was just getting excited. Okay. And I did, of course, touch last week depression in the second round as we're going through these things. And this week we also need to talk about letting go. We basically will make this session go for another 3 weeks or something at this rate. But we'll try. What I have to do is recap just a little bit from last week, because the number 151 is our magic number. That's what we were using last week. Remember, 151 is the numerical value of anger, and it is also the method in which we were discovering the cure for anger, and we were using the number 151. I'm not going to go through all the gematria mathematics that we did last week, because that would probably take me 40 minutes, which is how long it took last week. It's not about recapping, I'd have to say the whole thing again. But the point was, the numerical exploration that we went on, the gematria as taught by the Arizal, as taught by the Holy Ari of Northern Israel, Tzfat, 1600s, what we learnt was that the reason for anger is when we have a severe form of judgment which hasn't been infused with a soft form of judgment. And what we said was that a severe form of judgment is the judgment that stems from Gvura. Gvura is intensity. Gvura is extremely strong. Gvura, judgment as a result of Gvura, is absolute. It has no compassion. It is the cold, absolute way of looking at any situation based on the only facts that you've been presented and the refusal to accept anything else. Now, the problem with such a judgment is that you'll end up being extremely severe. Now, when you are using that form of judgment about your own scenarios in life, you'll always be severe. You'll always say it's not fair, you'll always curse the living daylights out of everybody else, and of course what you will end up with is anger. Anger is the product of having judged a situation. When you judge the situation with absolute severity, you become angry. And the example was, you cut off in traffic, you judge the situation, a person cut you off, now there's a traffic jam, and now you have to sit there and what are you going to do? You curse the living daylights out of everyone. And that was what happens if you take the name Elohim, which is one of the names of the manifestation of Hashem's energy within the universe. Elohim is judgment, and it is all about forced English is failing me. It is all about forced definition. It is all about definition is the result of contrast. It is all about looking at a situation without understanding how the contrast works together and saying what is and it is not the way I want it, and therefore when Elohim becomes bastardized and we end up with the 120 permutations of Elohim being able to manifest, they will manifest in a negative way, which is the way that we choose to draw that energy into our life, which is what leads to anger. What we then resolved was that the way to deal with it is by having Adni Elohim. When you take the numerical value of those two words and you mix them together, we end up with the correction. We get back to the 150 that we need. And what is Adni? It is the name of Elohim, is the name of the infinite as it manifests through absolute Gvura and judgment. Adni is the name as it relates to judgment via Malchut. Malchut is the bottom of the 10 Sefirot. It is a compassionate form of judgment. And when we insert compassion into severity, what we end up with is not anger, but rather a method called judgment, which leads to productive outcome. So of course we judge. I made that clear last week. Anyone that doesn't judge is not a hipster. Anyone that doesn't judge is an idiot. You're either blind and deaf and you have lost the sense of touch, or you judge. Because judge is making an assessment of your situation. Judge is when a person comes towards you with a knife and is yelling, "I'll kill you, I'll kill you, I'll kill you." And you go, "Hey man, no judgment, that's cool. If that's your culture, I accept that." That's not called not being judgmental, that's called making the wrong judgment. When a person comes at you with a knife and says, "I'm going to kill you, I'm going to kill you," assess the situation, size them up, and decide what you're going to do. Now, if a child comes up to you with a little rubber toy saying, "I'm going to kill you, I'm going to kill you, I'm going to kill you," and this is annoying you, so you have dropped malchut and you are only operating out of the sphere of gvura, that kid's going to come towards you and you're going to kick him as far as you can, you're going to whack their heads in. That's gvura, that's absolute anger. You're, "I was on the phone and you're making too much noise." Yeah, but there is some lack of compassion here. That's where malchut makes it altruistic. Malchut is what allows the Adni, the name, the realization of the existence of the infinite within this situation, in which case there is an acceptance and then an assessment. When there is acceptance and then assessment, then you will end up with a product that is more other-centered or that is more appropriate. And we do that all the time, hopefully, where we judge with compassion. Now, that was all last week, and that's the way we get rid of anger. Because anger is where there is no infinite, there is no Adni, there is no Shem Avaya, there is no name of the infinite, because there is no realization that the infinite exists within this moment. There is only the judgment based on self. As soon as we allow the Malchut, as soon as we allow the infinite into the context, then we end up with the mantra that we did last week, which is Hashem Melech, Hashem Moloch, Hashem Yimloch, La'olam Vayed. That the infinite rules and is the master of this moment, the infinite was the master of the previous moment, and the infinite is the master of the future moment, which means the same, that I came to this moment because the infinite has delivered me here. There is a divine consciousness that wants me here. It has brought me to this moment. It has not abandoned me, but I am in this moment quite deliberately. It is for me to choose what I am doing here. Why has the infinite brought me here? Why has Hashem delivered me to this moment? And then I'm open to the fact that I will be in the future, that in the future I will still be accompanied by the infinite, because the infinite will be with me in the future. Hashem Yimloch Le'olam Vayed. Hashem masters every single moment for all eternity. And what we did last week was we spoke about this, and then we used it as the mantra, the meditation, in order to, every time you feel pangs of anger coming on, that's okay, what has happened has happened, and that might make you upset, but by inserting this mantra into your life, you realize that although life sucks at this moment, or life is not going according to plan at this moment, it is not your life to plan. You are living the life as planned and as guided by the infinite. And that's what we did last week. If you have any questions on what I just said, and you weren't here last week, please don't judge what I just said. Watch the video from last week. This week, I want to talk about jealousy. Jealousy. Once again, we need the 151. Now, I don't know if I mentioned last week, there is a way of dealing with this, the Arizal teaches, in a very different way. Now, the way the Arizal tells us to deal with these things, I wouldn't recommend. And the reason is because it doesn't just happen like that. Mikveh. The numerical value of mikveh is 151. Who would have guessed? Everything is 151 nowadays. And the idea of a mikveh is submerging oneself and immersing oneself in a natural body of water. When one immerses themselves in a body of water on a regular basis, the Arizal says, this helps bring about a tikkun within the body. It helps give energy to the soul in order to overcome the component of self that struggles with anger. The Arizal says, because when you immerse yourself in water, you are completely submerged. You are all encompassed by something around you. What is water? Water is a physical property of which the spiritual makeup is incredibly powerful. Water is the single thing that NASA looks for wherever they go in the universe, as I like to point out. And that's because where there is water, there is a greater chance of life. If there is no water, there is no chance of life. And so therefore, what we look for is water. when I say we, I don't mean me and my team at NASA. I'm saying we as in humanity. Okay, when I used to work at NASA, my job wasn't to look for water. It was to clean the toilets. but we at NASA...
There's water.
There is a lot of water in the toilets. I'm not sure why they're looking at Mars. I flushed heaps. So we're always looking for water. Why? Because water is the elixir of life. Water keeps us moist. Water helps us grow. Water washes us. Water cleanses us. Water, with all its physical properties and attributes, it's because its spiritual makeup is that powerful. The nitzutz eloki, the spiritual energy that allows water to exist, is one of profound nature. And if one immerses themselves in that, that will have an impact. Now, if you want to immerse yourself in a more abstract sense, ein mayim ela Torah, the Torah is compared to water. If you learn spirituality, if you learn Torah, it will rub off on you and change your personality. But that only works if you immerse yourself in it. Of course, if you take everything on... So if you have a cup of water and you drink it, that's not called an immersion. It's good. It has a profound effect on you. It keeps you alive. But immersion is a whole different thing. Immersion is the act of ego abnegation. When you are underwater, you can't breathe. You are completely confined, and you are completely surrounded by this water. And you have to appreciate what it is, and you have to respect it. Because if you don't, you die. When you come up for air. And it leads to a whole changing attitude. Anyway, the next 151 I want to talk about is jealousy. Jealousy, the root word of the Hebrew word kin'ah, which is jealousy, is kuf nun aleph. Kuf is 100, nun is 50, aleph is 1. So once again, we've got 151, which shows how it's similar to ka'as, which is anger, which is 151, which means that the root problem of these two seems to be the same. When you are jealous, you actually have a false claim of ownership on someone else's property. So let's say, we'll give three different examples. Let's say it is winter, and you have a measly raincoat, and someone walks past in a beautiful down coat. It is so soft and warm and comfortable, and you're there in your poncho running through the cold wintry rain, and this person's just, I don't know, there's almost this summer glow about them in the way they're walking about. And you look at them, and jealousy is the moment that you say, I should have that coat. Not only should I have that coat, but that person shouldn't have that coat. No judgment, I'm not judging the person, I'm just saying that coat I should have, and I'm jealous, and I really want it. And in your mind, you've already laid ownership on it. There's a strange sense of ownership on things that you don't have when you're jealous. Example number two, if you're a car buff, you see someone driving past in a beautiful car, and it's just about, let's say you earn 150 grand a year, and you've got no other expenses. So you can afford to drive, I don't know. No, you can't afford a Lamborghini on 150. You can drive a Lexus. You can buy the new RX. Okay. But then you see someone driving the new Mercedes ML. And you're like, which is a bit more expensive. And you're like, jealous. Because they're in your league, but they're just a bit out. And the jealousy leads to a false sense of entitlement that you should have had that. It's not admiration. Admiration is not jealousy. When a beautiful car drives past and people go, nice car, they're not necessarily jealous. That could be the tikkun to jealousy. That could be the way of fixing jealousy, because it's a form of admiration. Admiration is actually going to be the way we deal with jealousy, but we're not jumping the gun. I mentioned last week that the 10th commandment of the 10 commandments, because remember I spoke about our commandments are not commandments, they're aser adibrot, they're 10 murmurings, they're devarim, they're words, they're not commandments. The 10th of the murmurings, The tenth of the Aseret HaDibrot is don't be jealous. Each of the last five relate to the first five. Number 10 relates to number 1. Number 10 is don't be jealous. Number 1 is I am the infinite. I took you out of Egypt. I am the one that causes everything to exist. I am the soul within everything. I am the night. I am the day. I am air. I am solid. I am liquid. I am your income. I am you. You are me. When we talk about the infinite, it can't be there's me and there's the infinite, because then how do you have the infinite but only over there? So some people say infinite is like, an example of infinite is, what's your favorite food? carrots. I'm going to assign a favorite food.
I was thinking, I was with you there. Now you asked me something else.
I've asked you to become self-centered. Yeah. Okay, gefilte fish. So if I said, I can give you an infinite amount of gefilte fish, have you got infinity? No, you've just got an infinite amount of gefilte fish, which is not a true definition of infinity. Infinity is non-divisible, all option. So when I talk about Hashem being the infinite, there is no, oh, it's infinite out there, but over here it's finite. All of finite existence exists within the infinite. All of finite existence exists within the infinite. So when Hashem says, Anoichi Hashem Elokecha, I am your God, he's not saying, oh, by the way, I'm your God, don't have any other gods. That's a whole separate discussion. It's, I am the infinite. I am you, and you're a part of me. I am the seat you're sitting on. I am the chair. I am the floor. I am the food. I am the air. I am the water. I am space. I am every star. I am all of that, and I am more, because I am the soul of all those things. I am the life of all those things. I am the death of all those things, and all those things don't even exist within me, because I am also all the options of those things not existing. I'm not going to get into the whole definition of Ein Sof, but basically when Hashem says, I am, and then we get jealous, what's the problem? Jealousy is the denial of the infinite. It's the denial that this exists because this is how it's meant to exist. And the problem with that is when a person is jealous, they are living a life of isolation. I don't have, because this is all I do have, and I want that, and I'm not going to get it. What are you really saying? I have no purpose, my life has no point, and I'm charting my own course forward. Another beautiful Facebook thing is really like, I'm charting I'm taking control of my life, I am charting the course forward. That's a load of nonsense. We don't chart our own course, we explore our future, we discover our future, but we don't chart it, we don't control it. Our decisions lead to new occurrences taking place. Right now, the future is infinite. Nobody knows what's going to happen in an hour. You don't. You don't know what's going to happen. You think, oh, I'm going to be at home. Who says? I can list you right now a dozen different options of what might happen. Good and bad. We have no idea what's going to happen in an hour. How do you know that North Korea is not going to be launching something? You didn't even think of that, huh? You didn't even think about North Korea. It's not on your radar. You're not as nuts as me. You don't know. For all you know, who knows what could happen? We think we know what's going to happen. We don't know what's going to happen. Right now, the future remains with an infinite number of options. I just want you to think about that. Right now, your future has an infinite number of options. Everything from a heart attack to winning the lottery. Everything from happiness to sadness. Quick and slow. No idea. Which means the whole future right now is completely contained and combined with the infinite, is part of Hashem. Which is an incredibly exciting thing. Because that means, no matter what the outcome, it's a part of the infinite. The infinite is a consciousness. The consciousness wills. And therefore, no matter what decision I make, I won't be alone in that decision. That also means that everything that goes on right now, which once was an option of the future. Remember, right now is an option that could have been. It's now the only option as you sit here. None of you went to the toilet. Still none of you have gone to the toilet. All these were options, but you're actualizing a new reality every moment. And as you do that, you realize that all you're doing is you're drawing out of the infinite a particular path. The infinite is Hashem. Hashem, everything is good. Whether we see it or not, we'll discuss that in a sec. But what I'm saying is that jealousy is the result of saying, I should have had that. That should be mine. If you should have had it, you would have it. The fact that you don't have it means you don't need it. The fact that you're getting upset, go back to option one of 151. You're starting to get a bit caustic. You're starting to get a bit angry. You're starting to get a bit jealous. Oh, that must be because there is a complete lack of acceptance that this moment is completely owned by the infinite, of which I am experiencing a moment of consciousness, of which I am living what is meant to be lived. And the only product of jealousy will be anger, negativity. You're not going to get anything being jealous. People say, no, it leads to motivation. Rubbish. Motivation leads to motivation. Want leads to motivation. But jealousy, which is the negative act of taking ownership of something that someone else has, almost to their own, to their detriment, that is not acceptance of reality. And that is the problem. Now, I don't need to labor jealousy. I think we've all experienced jealousy, yes? Or maybe I'm laboring this for the people that have no idea what I'm talking about. The Baal Shem Tov has an interesting idea on how to tackle jealousy. So last week we taught a mantra. This week I'm not teaching a mantra for jealousy. Last week I taught a mantra of Hashem Melech, Hashem Melech, Hashem Imloch, Le'olam Vayed, which was for anger, which was infuse this moment of judgment. When judging this moment that could easily become negative, infuse the infinite and realize this is the will of the infinite. I'm not alone. I'm here for a reason. And the example was when you're stuck in traffic on Queensway, you're next to Albert Park Lake. It's all stopped. Nothing's happening. You've got a flight in 45 minutes. You know that you're not making it across to the airport at this rate. So you could sit there swearing every single iteration of every single word in every single combination, giving every single person around you the everything. You could be doing anything. Or you could turn to the car that's not going anywhere, that's right next to you, and you smile. And you're smiling at the mother of a child who has Down syndrome. And sees no purpose in it, sees no joy in life, until a stranger in a car next to them gives them a genuine smile, a genuine sharing of happiness. We're both stuck in this. You with your tzaras, me with my tzaras, you're not alone, I'm with you. And who's to say your whole reason for existence was not that? Who's to say that every reincarnation that you have had, and every time your soul has come into the body, is only to get you to sit in traffic on that useless day and smile at a complete stranger? Who's to say that wasn't the point? No, my point was to have kids. My point was to get married. Who said? We have many things to do in our life, but only one of those things is the point of why we exist. Anger is the moment of where you deny that this moment has meaning. I don't accept this moment. I'm angry. Inserting the shame, inserting the name, inserting the infinite into it says, no, I'm meant to be here. Exact same sequence with jealousy. I don't accept that I don't have that. It's not fair that they have it and I don't. Stop it. Who said that you were meant to have it? You want it. Oh, that's a different thing. It just sounded like you were planning on taking it, or that you had some negative feelings towards that person. You wanting it is one thing, but jealousy is not wanting. Jealousy is the negativity, and for that we have to insert. Now the Baal Shem Tov though says, don't just start inserting the infinite into jealousy. Because jealousy is a very silly thing, and it's a very easy thing to fix. And jealousy in truth is not always bad. You can be jealous of something good. Jealousy, although usually is bad, jealousy could be harnessed as a form of motivation if it's within growth. You can be jealous of someone else's spiritual enlightenment. That's a time that you're allowed to be jealous. You can be jealous of someone else's spiritual enlightenment. Because when you see someone else experiencing spiritual enlightenment, and you say, oh, I'm jealous, what you're really saying is that I too want spiritual enlightenment. But remember, spiritual enlightenment in our teaching is not that you walk around and you can now have X-ray laser vision. Spiritual enlightenment is the cessation to exist. So if you were, it's like being jealous of a dead person. It's not a negative. If you're jealous of dead people, that's a weird thing. But the jealousy of enlightenment is that I am jealous of this individual. I too... Okay. I too want to cease to exist. I too don't want to be in this state of... I too don't want to be in this state of materialism. I too don't want to be in this state of distraction. I would love to discover absolute ego abnegation. Okay, that's a form of jealousy that is seen as pious. And what's the difference between jealousy and zealousy? A J and a Z. I saw that online. It's cute. So the Baal Shem Tov says there's a way to tackle. The Baal Shem Tov had a number of interesting methods of dealing with problems. He often used to tell his students, if you have a problem with ruminating thoughts, or you have a problem with strange thoughts entering into your mind, don't discard them. Don't detach from them. None of that. Head straight into them. Like, if you're driving a car and there's a bad thought, just charge right into it and find out what is going on. And the Baal Shem said, tackle your foreign thoughts. Tackle your machshava zoros. As I mentioned last week, the Alter Rebbe, Rabbi Shnizam of Liadi, two generations later of Hasidic mystics, said, nope, don't tackle your thoughts head on because you don't know how to dissect your thoughts. This was something that was appropriate for the students of the Baal Shem Tov because, for example, the Baal Shem Tov teaches, if you are having inappropriate sexual thoughts, then, and it's happening at a time of prayer, don't discard them. Go deep within and work out if sexuality in Judaism is a form of intimate union. It's something that can only take place within a loving relationship. It is something that only takes place when one wants to express absolute love together with another. That's the only time one would ever engage in sex. So you're saying if you're having impure, inappropriate sexual thoughts, there is something wrong with love deep within. Go and explore. Who are you not loving? Where is your issue? It's manifesting in this strange negative thought because love has become strange and negative within. The Alter Rebbe said, don't touch it. Don't touch it. The Baal Shem Tov is right, but we don't know how to explore our thoughts in that way. And it's too dangerous. It's dangerous to start exploring our thoughts. So, not don't touch it, but don't just layperson start going, oh yes, I'm going to explore my thoughts. There's got to be a structure, there's got to be guidance, and not to just do it because you want to. But that's the Baal Shem Tov's general attitude, is nothing is bad in this world. Everything that is bad is there to teach you something that you never would have known if not for this bad thing. Anything that is negative that occurs in our life, and I am the first one to say this because I'm a strong believer of this, I can, in my office, I have a list of laws, and every law has a name. I've got Hilton's Law, I've got Miriam's Law, I've got Rodney's Law. Nope, these are all people none of you have ever met. But they are all people that as a result of something that went on in our relationship, I learned something. Even though I was badly hurt, or I had badly hurt someone, and after realizing what had happened and learnt from it, I wrote their name on my board, and I've got a list of laws. I can tell you the story behind each person and what I learnt from it. Each one of those stories is a bad story. It's a sad story. Someone got hurt. Someone went through excruciating emotional pain. Either me or another person, but I was involved. I was present. And I can tell you, out of each one of those things, incredible lessons were learnt. Incredible life-changing lessons. Lessons that I could have read every single Harvard Business Review book that they sell in the airports. And all the behavioral psychology books and all the psycho babble books and all of them, which I actually do love reading. But none of them taught me anything. They all are al levavachem. In the Shema we say that these words of the Shema should be al levavachem, on your heart. So the commentaries will say it shouldn't be al levavachem, it should be bil vavachem, inside your heart. Get these holy words and put them in your heart. And the commentaries say, rubbish. You can't put anything in your heart. You can't put anything in anyone's heart. A teacher can't enter someone else's heart. A parent can't enter someone else's heart. A lover can't enter someone else's heart. All we can do is place things on top of... Well, that's bad when it's my phone. go away. Why do we say Bil Vavachem? Why is it on our heart? Because all we can do is stack information. Stack teachings on people's heart. When the heart breaks, those teachings fall in. Sounds cliche, but think about it. All those books and all the years of university and all the things you ever learn will never make you a better person. What they will help you a little. That's a bit of a heavy call. But where they will really become important is when your heart breaks. When you are put through extreme challenge, those things will sink right in. And you'll click into gear. Often you can read, how many times have you heard, don't judge another until you've walked a million miles in their shoes? Or how many times have you heard, treat others as you want to treat yourself? These are cliche. cliche means they're true, but we don't care. We don't really believe in it. It's not real. It's true, but it's not real. And then something happens in your life and you never judge another person again. Or, you know, these people like make the most out of life. Then you meet someone who had cancer and they can tell you about what making most of life is. It's a whole, it's when the heart breaks, so to speak, that we actually end up in a much better way. So I can tell you that all the negative things that happen in our life are the greatest teachings, both for us and for the future generations. The most amazing things that you'll ever discover will be in a time of stress, anxiety, and sadness. And when I say that, of course, I mean depression and anger and everything else. You're not allowed to? Yes, you're not allowed to. But if you do, trust me, there's a lesson in there. That doesn't justify it. It just allows good to grow from the bad. What does the Baal Shem Tov say? What's the tikkun? What is the way to tackle jealousy? Tackle it head on. Charge right into it. As someone walks past and they've got a beautiful feather down coat on, and you go, oh, that is, I should have that coat. Just freeze that. And say, oh, what a beautiful coat. Oh, what a beautiful coat. And if you're really brave, you'll say, I'm so happy for that person that they've got a beautiful coat. We need to become more like men. And every time a red Ferrari goes by, just go, ooh. It's just pure admiration. Knucklehead stuff. Easy. As soon as we start saying, I want that Ferrari, stop. So why do I want that Ferrari? Oh, it's beautiful. What?
Every time I see Ferrari, I just think about how much this poor guy is paying for.
Yeah. I have to apologize. I didn't realize we had such a sophisticated crowd. Such an empathetic crowd. Compassionate crowd. Non-materialistic. And I say that tongue-in-cheek, that's really cool. Whenever it is that we see someone else who has something, the first thing is we should say, why do we want that? Oh, because it's nice. Oh, because it's beautiful. Oh, because it's gorgeous. Just focus on that. Focus on the good. Focus on the gorgeous. Focus on the beauty. And allow yourself to slowly be removed from the subjective experience and turn it into an objective. That's what the Baal Shem Tov says. There's no mantra for jealousy. There is an attitude shift. When you find you're saying, I want it, ask yourself, why do I want it? Ah, because it's beautiful. Let me take some time and admire it. And when you admire it, you then move yourself into feeling good for the person that has it. And if you want, you can go even further to say, no, I'm not going to say, because it's negative. It's not from the Baal Shem Tov. I was about to insert my own thing. Depression. We didn't touch depression at all last week. We touched it 2 weeks ago. Depression is when you are in the darkness and you have stopped. That's how we're defining. So you're in that dark state and you've stopped moving. As long as you keep moving, you move because you've got hope. So as long as you keep moving, you've got hope. The moment you stop moving is the moment you've lost hope. The moment you've lost hope is the moment that the darkness envelops you and you become debilitated. We're now approaching Pesach. When the 10 plagues afflicted Egypt, there was the plague of darkness. Ooh, what's so bad about darkness? I wish it was dark for 3 days. I'd have an excuse not to get up. Because my body clock, I didn't realize it was daytime because it was nighttime. What sort of plague is that? And the truth is the darkness was so dense that people froze. They couldn't move. It was so intense, so thick, that people froze. Depression is that feeling of freezing, that feeling of, I can't go on, that feeling of inability to climb out. Now, the problem with depression is it is full body. The problem with depression is that it is a full body experience. You never get someone who's depressed in their hands. My hands are feeling a bit slack, but I'm feeling great. And you never get people who are like, I'm just feeling a bit depressed, but my legs, they want to go running. Generally, when it's depression, it's, I can't be bothered. moving, I can't be bothered eating, I can't be bothered running, I can't be bothered feeling, I can't be bothered anything. And it's not that I'm low of energy because I've worked hard, it's I'm sapped of energy because my internal core has drained me, so to speak. That's what it feels like, that at your very core there is a vacuum, and that vacuum is sucking in whatever vibrant energy you have. And there is no light. There is no light. It can be a spring day. It's not even that you look at the world negatively. That's a negative person. We're just talking about where there's no point. And there's no point to even giving up. It's not that you are actively giving up. It's just being. I know what that feels like. I don't know if anyone else in this room knows what that feels like. But it's a horrible place to be. And the Alter Rebbe says we don't just tackle depression. You don't. The way of dealing with depression is there's a very cute cartoon that's been going around online for the last few years. It's a drawn cartoon, not an animated cartoon. And the cartoon is explaining the difference between empathy and sympathy. The difference is sympathy is you see someone who's in a dark space, and so the cartoon is of a person in a hole. And the person outside the hole is, hey, let me throw you a ladder. I'll help you get out. That's sympathy. I understand you're in a hole. I'll help you. Empathy is the picture is the person in at the top of the hole climbs down into the hole and sits down with the person and puts their arms around them. That's empathy. Is that you get into the darkness, not that you experience darkness, but you allow yourself enough feeling to feel their darkness, and you enter into their space, and with that you can help bring them out. It's a completely different thing to, I see you're in a hole, here's the solution. Who likes a solution when you're having a good round of depression? No one wants to, do you keep your solutions? I want empathy, I want you to feel with me, and slowly, slowly. What's the difference? Is that when you're in that darkness, you can't climb up a ladder. If you could, you would have built the ladder yourself, if you've got so much energy. It's that the thought of climbing a ladder, it seems impossible. And what you do need is assistance in getting your foot, not getting yourself out of the hole, getting your foot onto the first rung. That is the impossible task. And why is that it's so impossible? Is because putting your foot on the first rung requires the same amount of energy as climbing out of the hole. It requires the energy to go from zero to one. There is the distance between one and a million is a far smaller than the distance between zero and one, because zero to one is a quantum leap. One to a million is just a natural progression. Natural progression. It is a lot harder if you don't know how to run 3 kilometers, than it is to run 16 kilometers if you can run. Someone who can run 5K can push themselves to 16K. Someone who can't run full stop, has never run, the muscles never used, can't run 1K. What'd you do? Oh, I just got out of my car. You know? It's a whole different thing. And therefore, the Alter Rebbe says in Tanya, when you're dealing with depression, you don't start climbing ladders. You have to realize you're a log. We are all logs. We're a shtickholz, a thick, big log. And what we need to do is, if you want to ignite a log, so I don't know how many of you are pyromaniacs, but I can tell you now, there are different types of logs that burn in different ways. There are different types of wood that burn in different ways. There's nothing like setting balsa wood on fire. There's nothing like setting wooden pallets on fire. This stuff is fun. But when you're being given a sack of blue gum or a sack of red gum, this stuff just doesn't catch. No amount of jiffy is going to light it. In order to light this sort of stuff, you need to splinter it. If you want to ignite yourself, you need to splinter yourself. If you want to climb out of that darkness, you need to splinter yourself. That's what the Alter Rebbe writes. Now, this is an interesting idea. How do we splinter ourselves? So the way we splinter ourselves is by doing little things. Things that are so small that you don't even see how they could help. That's where it starts. Yeah, and everyone who's in a good state will know, going for a walk is unbelievable. Someone who's ever been in a bad state knows full well walking does nothing. Climb, but it's not hard to walk. It's hard to catch up with friends. It's hard to go out for coffee. It's hard to go running. But it's not hard to walk. Especially if someone comes over and says, come, we're going for a walk. It's not hard to be dragged. You may not want to, but it's a lot easier than being told, what you need is to be with friends. Or you know, there are so many good causes you could get involved in. You know, I'll take your good causes and I'll tell you where to put them. Because really, while all those things are true, that's like saying, take the red gun, light it on fire, and you'll be warm. Yeah, the problem is, I haven't got kindling to light my red gun. Ah, but you have an axe. Take the axe and break the log. Don't worry about finding kindling. Break the log. Don't go out, don't do anything, just break yourself a little bit. That's what the Alter Rebbe says. Now, you'll say, oh, I don't know about this. Still, you're just making a smaller thing the thing to do. So, here is the one thing that people in darkness don't like hearing. And I will tell you that. People in darkness don't like hearing this. They don't like hearing that they have the ability to overcome this. I'm not mocking anyone right now. I know exactly what this feels like. And no one likes the feeling of being told that they've got the strength. Because then you've got the guilt that you're not utilizing the strength. And that's a very harsh thing. So I'm not saying this to anyone. I'm just quoting the writings of the mystics. So whatever you don't like here, don't shoot me. I'm just the messenger. The Alter Rebbe says in the Book of Tanya that Helam means hidden. This world in Hebrew is called Ha'olam, the world. Ha'olam and Helam have the same root. This world is the hiding of all that is good. Everything in this world is Be'etzem good. Everything in this world in essence is good. Everything that happens is good. Everything that exists is good. Ah, I don't see it. Of course you don't see it. Because this world is one big covering. This world is one big form of darkness. You don't see anything because everything is covered up. You don't see the tables because there are tablecloths on top. You don't see who I am because I wear clothing. You don't see who I am because I wear a specific face. You don't see who I am because I speak in a certain way. I don't let you in. Nobody lets anyone in. Nothing in this world lets anything see more than the veneer that it has. You have no idea what's inside a rock. You see the outside, you assume that's what's on the inside. You see a person, you assume you know them. We know nothing about anything. We don't see souls. We don't see energy. We don't see manifestations. We see tragedy after tragedy historically. We don't see any good. Occasionally there is good, but there is so much bad in this world. And occasionally there isn't so much bad in this world, but we don't see any spirituality. Occasionally we see spirituality, but we don't see how it's all connected. This world is ha'olam. This world is an olam shel nistar. It is an environment of where everything is concealed. And if you want to discover something, what do you have to do? You have to go digging. You want to find diamonds, you've got to dig. You want to get to know someone, you've got to live with them for 10 years. Nothing's real. You've got to keep peeling layers and layers and layers and layers and layers. And the Alter Rebbe says, if you realize that, we're also saying that at the core of everything, everything is good. How could everything be good? Because everything has a neshama. Everything has a soul. Everything has an essential good within it. Some of us, and some things in this world, are so covered with the helam. We are so layered that our conscious self has lost touch with our inner self. That is why people can commit crimes. That is why people can commit crimes and atrocities. That is why people can do the worst things to others, because they have lost touch of all that is good within them. Let me give you a very interesting example, and the philosophical ramification is brought by Maimonides, but not about this case, because Maimonides didn't live 70 years ago. If Hitler was bad at his core, then who could blame him for what he did? Can't blame him. He's a bad man. However, if Hitler is good at his core, Hitler has a soul, then he's a bad man. Then he can be blamed. You can't say a person is evil be'etzem. Nothing in this world is evil be'etzem. Nothing in this world is evil at its core. At its core, everything is actually not just a mix of good and bad. At the core of everything is absolute good. It's just that everything exists with so many layers that at a point, a person can reach a point that the layers have fused together and become so dense that there is no relationship between the external and the internal. You know, people can say, oh, I've tried meditating, it doesn't work. My brain doesn't stop. Ah, but some people it does, some people doesn't. That's right, I'm part of the people that doesn't. That's nonsense. It just is that you're in a much, you're in a more severe state right now of noise with and chatter within, so it's harder work. But say my brain, I'm physiologically completely different to the rest of the human race. Isn't that interesting? Well, then you should be living in a lab. You're a risk to society if you're so different. But by saying, no, I can't meditate, or by saying that Hitler is bad, be'etzem, or by saying any of the, lahavdil, I'm not comparing any of those, but by saying that I at my core am not good, allows me to then get away with not trying. What does that say for depression? And of course, when we say depression, we're not talking about clinical depression. We're talking about the darkness that people experience in their life when things are ongoingly not falling into place and they're just losing hope or have lost hope, but not to a point that they've created a new chemical pattern or a new pattern within the brain that actually requires either chemical intervention or professional intervention. We're talking about the stage before. Now, if a person sits in that darkness and says, the truth is there is good, I don't feel it, and I'm not going to feel it talking about it. However, the one thing I do have is the ability to overcome this current moment, which I'll explain in a sec, that we can do. And that the Alter Rebbe wrote his whole book of Tanya, one of the cardinal pieces of work that he wrote was about the person coming to the realization that we master ourselves. We are the master of our own self. And he said, if you're not, then you are not a human, you are an animal. You don't feel like an animal? Well, then be a human. Balz Rebbe doesn't seem to be the sort of person you go to for a hug. He's the sort of person you go to for very tough love, but is the person that is yelling at you till the day you die after 120 years of failing. This person's yelling at you like it's your first day on the football field. He's right there behind you. I believe in you, champ. Now go out there. Ah, but I got a walking frame. You get out there with that walking frame. I don't care if you have to move 1K an hour. We're going to move. Okay, fine. The speed has changed over the years, but the Alter Rebbe is there behind the human till the day that they die. And you know what the Alter Rebbe says about the human after he dies? You go get him, man! The Alter Rebbe just never gives up. The neshama, the soul keeps burning because you've lived a life of trying. And what the Alter Rebbe says is, what is the difference? And he brings the Zohar and he brings Kabbalah. What is the difference between an animal and a person? Is that an animal can't ascribe meaning to this moment. That's why I always say you never meet vegetarian lions. You never meet a lion that says, oh, those little zebras, they're so cute. How could people kill them? How could animals kill them? Have you seen the way they cry? Or like when we kill the mother zebra, we leave the babies. You don't get lions doing that. Does that mean lions are not compassionate? I don't know, they may be compassionate. You see animals cry. What animals don't have is a higher awareness of the meaning of this moment. All those books in the back, who said they were holy? Bunch of tree matter put on wooden shelves. You know, paper and wood. It's like the Amazon.
Stop it.
Yeah, maybe I took it too far, but that's. But who said that's holy? If any of those books fall on the floor, I'll kiss it. It's just pulp. Just pulp. Now, if I had a whole the Penguins classics over there, 6,000 books, and one of the, and I don't know. Plato's Republic fell on the floor, I wouldn't pick it up and go, oh, Baruch Hu. I wouldn't say anything. Just pick it up, put it back on the shelf. Why are those books holy and Plato's Republic not, to me? Who decided? You say, oh, because it's got Hebrew words printed. Rubbish. I know plenty of people that read Hebrew words and discard it. I made them holy. I made those books holy. Who are you, Menachem? Oh, I'm the bloke with the brain. I decided that those books were holy. When you marry someone, you say under the chuppah, Hareyat Mekudesh Esli B'Tabas U'Kadas Moshe V'Yisrael. You are Mekudesh to me. Mekudesh, you are holy to me. What does that mean? In the case of the man, he's saying, you, lady, are completely different from all other women in this universe. You are something special. You are the thing that I want to be with. You are the one that brings the most incredible things out of me. Oh, by the way, all those other ladies, none of them do that. None of them do that. You are holy. But no one else goes, hey, that lady, she's pretty holy to me. No, this person is holy to one other person. Why? Because of the consciousness of the moment. When you choose to use your brain to say, this isn't a lady, this isn't a man, this isn't a book, this isn't a piece of parchment, this is tefillin, this is a wife, this is a husband, this is a holy book, this is special. When you say that, you make it holy. Your children are holy to you. Your property is special to you. Why? Because you have ascribed value through thinking about it and saying, although there are many books in the world, this book is different. Lions don't say, although there are many zebras in the world, this one I won't eat. It's a baby zebra. They don't. I'm hungry, I eat. I'm not hungry, I don't eat. Zebras live around lions when lions aren't hungry. When lions are hungry, zebras don't live. It's simple as that. They don't have a brain. Of course they've got a brain. I am hungry, go and hunt. They're completely aware of their feelings and what to do about them. They call that instinct. But the ability to overrule self. You never get a lion go, it's Yom Kippur. It's Yom Kippur. I'd love to, but Yom Kippur. You don't get it. You don't get, you don't get any animal crying about other animals en masse, like mourning. Elephants remember things. But elephants don't say, my parents remember. Elephants remember, but elephants don't say, oh, my parents, they saw this lion. We remember this. Many generations ago, the lion did this to our ancestors. It doesn't happen. They can't ascribe meaning. But the Alter Rebbe says, there is one species that has the ability to do that. There is one species that has a fourth part of the brain that no other species in the universe has. And that is the human species. And what is the human species able to do? Ascribe meaning. Live in a state of higher consciousness. Overrule self. I am able to say, I'm not eating. I'm vegetarian. I'm not eating. It's Yom Kippur. I love this person. It's special. I think this is special. That parchment is not dead animal. It is parchment. It is a Torah scroll. I am able to say, that's not candles. That's Shabbat candles. I'm able to ascribe meaning to everything. And when I say it, look, none of you go like, what? He lost me around 3 minutes ago. You're all saying, oh yes, parchment. Yes, yes, books. You all know what I'm talking about. Because we're all humans, and humans can ascribe value because we have higher consciousness. And being that we have higher consciousness, we can do one more thing that no one likes to hear. We control our emotions. We are able to override our feelings. Ah, but that person wronged me? Okay. That's why we get frustrated. Frustration is a form of tension. Tension only exists when two things are pulling or pushing at the same time. You don't get... You ever played tug of war with a 2-year-old? It's not really called tug of war, it's called tug. It's tug! Because there's no war. There's no tension. It's just a bit of friction as the kid slides along the floor. That's it. Nothing that we can't deal with. You don't ever get frustrated like, oh, this bloody 2-year-old, come on. Because there's no tension. The only time you get tense is like, come on, get him! That's tension. And when you are presented with a moment of where you can feel this, or you know you can feel that, we have internal tension. I want to be angry. Urgh, it's not fair. Why can't I be angry right now? Yesterday, I genuinely wanted to be angry at someone. But because I preached the gospel of anger, it didn't make it into any of the testaments. Because I had to think about this. Like, I want to get angry at someone. I said to Rochel, I'm telling you, if I got angry right now, I would have said this to them. Ooh, that would be finished. But I didn't. Now, this isn't about, oh, Menachem, aren't you strong? Because we all experience moments of self-restraint. We've all done it. You all have. Otherwise, you'd be like, wow, this man... incredible controller of anger. We've all done it. We just don't like to do it. Because we can override our emotion, we just don't like to. No one likes to be told that we can master our emotions, except the Alter Rebbe, who says, oh, you don't like hearing it? Well, let me just tell you, it's part of being a human being. I don't mean to ruin your day. I'm just saying, the same way you get hungry in the morning and you get tired at night, you can master your emotions. What you need to do is practice it. Therefore, he says, it's time to start splintering your log. Start splintering your log. Start with some small steps that will fire you up. Say, it doesn't make sense. He said, the book of Tanya does not justify anything. It's one of the most fascinating books. There is in the book of Tanya, which is all about, it's the book of mastery for the person that struggles. It's not the book of mastery for the master. It's for the person who really struggles in day-to-day life. And there is not once an argument as to why we should believe in God. There is not once an argument as to why what he is saying is true. He does not support himself once. In fact, the Alter Rebbe puts very little theory before any action. He goes action, theory, action, theory, action, theory. And he follows the Jewish model of education. The Jewish model of education is Nasa v'nishma, Nasa v'nishma, Nasa v'nishma. We will do and then we will listen. We will do and we will learn. We will do and we will learn. We will do and we will learn. The Jewish method of education is teach kids how to sing the prayers. Don't teach them what it means. Teach them how to sing it. Teach them all the catchy tunes. And then when they're older, hopefully they learn. We do, it's the form of Jewish education. We learn through action. We learn the theory when we've got a brain. We don't try to get out of problems by learning about the problem. We start getting out of problems by embodying being out of it. In Kabbalah, it talks about that we have three levushim, machshav dibro maisa. We have three garments, our thoughts, our speech, and our actions. Generally, you put on the clothing that speak who you are, right? If you're an emo, how do you dress? No emos here. Pardon?
Black.
Emos dress in black?
Yeah.
Yeah, a bit more extreme than goths. You know what the goths are? Lovely people, they just look scary. Goths, I'm a goth inside, so I dress like this on the outside. I've got the white paint on, I've got the black clothes, I've got the silver studs. Looking good. Looking really deathly. It's good. It's a nice look. By the way, I'm a charming lawyer, but I'd like to dress like this. If you're at a music festival, how do you dress? Well, it just depends which music festival.
Skinny jeans and band shirt.
There you are. If you're a 1960s Woodstock person, what do you wear? Nothing. Just hold a bottle right here. Just cover it up. Just when the camera's going past. The way we dress tells you who I am. My levushim, my thoughts tell me what I'm thinking. My words tell you what I'm thinking. My actions tell you what I'm thinking. You can tell a person by the way they speak. If a person speaks grob, a person speaks in an uncouth, dirty way, trust me, that's what's going on inside. If a person dresses in a certain way, that's what they're thinking right now. There's a reverse though. According to Kabbalah, if you change your levushim, you'll change your etzem. Change the way you dress, you change the way you feel. And everyone here knows that. If you're a woman, put on a pair of heels. If you're a man, put on a pair of leather shoes, put on a suit and tie, you will feel very different to when you're walking around in sneakers, tracksuit pants, and a singlet. You don't feel the same. Both can be comfortable, one can be uncomfortable, you don't feel the same. Very few people, actually feel no difference, but most people feel a difference depending on what they're dressed in. Speak with a certain accent, and you will behave in a certain way. That's why people want to be posh. Start speaking in a rather posh way. They tend to draw out the ends of their words, and there's always this English intonation in how, and automatically you're like mesmerized. Absolutely, absolutely. Right? And that's it. But if you want to sound like an idiot, you put on an American accent.
I'm an idiot.
Only if you want to sound like one. Doesn't mean you are. So.
No.
No, don't don't talk. You're ruining my example. So the problem is when Audrey talks, I have such respect. Anyway. So, but I'll tell you interesting studies that have taken place in American prisons is where they manipulate the way people wrote and it changed their behavior. So what we find in Kabbalah is if you change your levushim, it can actually have an adverse effect on it, a positive effect, but it has a reverse effect on you. So if we are experiencing that darkness, the Alter Rebbe says, I can't explain too much to you except the following thing. A, you are master of your own emotions. That doesn't mean you brought this on, and it doesn't mean by thinking about it you're going to climb out. But if you do that and you combine it with your levushim, change your levushim, then you begin to splinter your log. Let me workshop this for you. Depression is a full body experience. It takes your mind, it takes your body, it takes everything. There is only one thing that we have that is a full body experience of the reverse. When a person is going through depression, they're completely drawing in and destroying. There is only one thing that is the exact opposite of where you are completely outgoing and creating. And that is the act of tzedakah. Charity. Charity is a full body experience. You say, no, it's not. Put my hand in my pocket and put it in. Say, no, no, no. If you think this is charity, you're wrong. This isn't charity. This is the act of giving charity. Charity is where you give. How did you get it? I went to work. Who went to work? When you go to work, you go to work. Your mind's at work. Your body's at work. Earning money is a full body experience. It's a full body effort. You can't be at work and be distracted. You can be, but you're not going to be an effective worker. If you want to be an effective worker, you've got to be there. You earn the money because you arrived to work. What is charity? Charity is giving of yourself to another. I earned this, it's mine, and now I'm giving it to you. What is the act of charity? It is the act of bettering someone else's life by giving of yourself. Whether that is giving money or whether it's giving time, I don't really care. But giving charity. What is charity? Charity is not, it's not planting trees in Israel. That's a good cause. But when we're talking about charity, in these things, we're talking about very specific. Charity is the act of helping the poor. Helping the poor. Now, whether it's a poor person, a poor organization, you want to start nitpicking, I don't know. But generally, when we talk colloquially about tzedakah, we're talking about giving to those who don't have. Giving those that don't have. I don't have to explain this to you. Because I'm employing the law of Nasa Venishma. I'm employing the law of changing your levushim to change your behavior. I'm employing the law of where you change certain actions and it changes how you feel. And so the Alter Rebbe says, give tzedakah. Go. Go down Chapel Street or go down Barclay Street and go to one of the missions and say, I'm here. What can $50 do for you? And listen. I say $50, you can buy this person some clothes, this person a bed for the night, this person a meal. That's what $50. Listen, and then give, and walk away. I challenge you. I challenge you to do that. That when you're feeling down, go down, and find something, and contribute. Ah, I don't have money. Give time. Ah, I don't have time. Find either time or money. just, this is nonsense. We're not going in this vicious circle. Be here all night. So, I'm not explaining this to you because it's not the scope of tonight. And so last week we learned a mantra for anger. This week we learned replaced jealousy with admiration. And now I'm telling you that for the depression is to give. To give and realize what you're giving. Realize that the thing you're giving to this person... Oh, sorry, the Helen. Come back to there. This world is darkness. But deep within, all darkness is good. You look at a person and you see that they've got no teeth and they're down and out and they're homeless or they're a prostitute or they're whatever they are and they're working the streets because literally to make another buck, you're looking at someone who has virtually no life. You... In your state of sadness, and in your state of grievance, and in your state of depression, have just become their light. Without you, this girl had to sell her body for $25. Without you, this bloke had to find a bridge. Without you, this child was roaming the streets for another night. Without you, and without you, their life would have continued as planned. She would have sold her body. He would have found himself another hit. This person would have ended up under a bridge. And then out of nowhere, a miracle happens. Out of nowhere, a miracle happens. Out in the darkness, in the tachlis of the goals, in the absolute darkness of this person's individual call of exile, comes a light. And who's the light? You. And you'll say, ah, but it's just because I had $50. It's just me. Nah. How do you know you didn't live for this moment to be down in the dumps, to walk with your $50 down to St. Kilda and give someone who has walked the streets and never had any love? How do you know this isn't the reason why you exist? And it is only through your depression, it is only through your darkness that this person gains. It is only because you suffer that this person who's suffering is going to get the light. It is only because of you, of this, what all the negativity that has brought you to this point, that this person finally gets to get something better. And who's to say then, for this person, what are they going to worship? They're going to worship your depression. Because they see it, and everyone else sees it, and you will come to see it through the actions that you take. And that's the Helam. That's where you realize this darkness actually has a good within it. I am the good in it, just as there is good deep within me. And as we start focusing on the good within the darkness, we stop focusing on the darkness that is mechaser, that is covering the light, and we start focusing on the light that is in the darkness. Everything I've just said is theory. If you want to know what I'm talking about, you're going to have to put it into practice. Now, I've got a whole lot of other stuff. Of course, I don't have enough time, as every course goes. But I also, we advertised letting go. That was the other part of the series, right? Letting go. So it's very easy, just let go. Okay, I covered it. If you want just a few words of maybe a bit of an epilogue. So what do I mean? What have we said about depression, jealousy, and anger? Is that while they are all natural, they are all a result of a method of thinking of being absolutely alone. Absolutely alone. In the anger, I am alone, and therefore I judge this situation and say, it's not fair. If I was the master of the world, it wouldn't have happened like this. I reinsert the master of the world and realize you're a part of its plan and you are not the master of the plan. Jealousy, if it was up to me, I'd have that and that person wouldn't have it. Accept the situation, admire it, and say, oh, this is Marabu Masecha. How great are the works of the infinite to be, you see the red Ferrari. Don't go, oh, say, this is incredible. How has man created such a beautiful beast? You see a beautiful garment. How is it that a person has created such a beautiful thing? You see an incredible steak, and it's on someone else's plate, and it costs $72, and you can only afford the $10 spring rolls. You say, what chef is able to deliver this? Be filled with admiration. You having a depressed moment? Don't worry. Don't climb out of it. Just give stock a... I can't, Mershalat Alev. The mind masters the emotion. No, it's not true. Oh, sorry, I thought you were human. I must have got a bit mixed up. Go look in the mirror and realize that you're a human. So what about letting go? What is letting go? What is holding on? Holding on is another symptom of everything else we've just said. You did this to me. You did this to me. That person did this to me. I can't forgive them. I can't forgive them. Why? Because they did this to me. And what? Nothing was learnt? Nothing was gained? You didn't find anything in this? This happened for no reason? There is no law of Hashkacha Pratis. There is no law of divine providence. There is absolutely no good that could be learnt from this moment? Nah. Well, then you haven't finished the story. You haven't finished the story. The only person that suffers when you don't let go is you. Now, of course, you all knew I was going to say that. But really, the issue with letting go is whether you have the strength to let go. Whether you have the strength to let go is no different to the strength of mastering anger, or mastering jealousy, or mastering depression. Now you say, Menachem, that's a cop-out. You know what? It's true. I ran out of time. But the principle is the same. And that's why it was linked to this class. Let me finish where we started 3 weeks ago. And of course I apologize that I didn't get through everything. But hey, Pesach's almost done, and we'll be back in no time. This series was in honor of Pesach. And we started with the idea of Metzorim. We all have our Metzorim. Metzorim are gvulim. They are our limitations. They are self-imposed barriers. Mitzrayim and Metzorim, Yitziat Mitzrayim, the exodus of Egypt, Yitziat Metzorim, the exodus of our confines. Confines are more often than not self-imposed. They are more often than not self-imposed. They don't look self-imposed. Well, what we've looked this week is that that's because we thought they weren't self-imposed. But anger is a self-driven feeling. Jealousy is self-created. And depression is self-managed. And we can actually break free. There is only one way, though, is the realization that the energy is not outside, the energy is inside. It is not that I'm waiting for the miracle, as I think I told the joke 3 weeks ago, that the person's drowning. The person's drowning. And a ship comes along. And he says, no, I'm praying to God, there'll be a miracle, don't worry. And then, I told him, the submarine comes, he goes, no, I'm praying to God, a miracle's going to come. Then the helicopter came, no, I'm praying to God, a miracle will come. And then the person drowns, comes up, and God says, what's going on? He says, where was the miracle? He says, I sent you a ship, a submarine, and a helicopter, what else could I do? So the miracles are always there, we're always looking. When the Jews were in Egypt, they stopped looking. And when they stopped looking, Moses came along. When they stopped looking, a sea split. They didn't expect to see the split. They just put one foot in front of the other and they walked. And then they got to the sea and one man kept walking. Nachshon ben Aminadav walked into the ocean. Well, you don't think he was a bit nervous? He was like, no, don't worry, fellas, I read the book. You know, he is the story of which we live happily ever after. But before he lived happily ever after, he wasn't living happily ever after. He was Hansel and Gretel while they were still in the cage. And he walks into the ocean and the sea splits. Where did he get the notion to do that? No one told him to. Something within. The Metzorim are gvulin that are outside of us. The way to Yitziyat, to go out of our confines, is by leaving from within. And the biggest confines of anger, jealousy, and depression are things that only can be fixed from in. No other person can fix it for us. No outside philosophy is going to fix it for us. It is only the willpower from within, coupled with a bit of philosophy, a bit of teaching. And so I bless everyone that today is the third day of Nisan, the month in which Pesach takes place. The energy of Nisan is an increased energy of Yitziat Mitzrayim. It is the energy of leaving one's own confines. And what that means when we say the muzzle, the energy, what are these words that these hippies use? Energy is that. You plug your phone in, it becomes filled with charge. Energy is charge. But if you want the charge, you've got to plug in. You've got to plug into the month of Nisan. What does that mean? How do you plug in? Make a decision. Do something. Do something. Say, I'm going to do this. And see how much easier it is if you try in this month to achieve something new than it is any other time of the year. Oh, I tried, it was hard. Well, I didn't say it's easy. I just said that your bets, if you're a betting person, it's worth putting $5 down that you're going to succeed this month more than the other 11 months of the Hebrew calendar. Because the energy, you plug your phone in, you ever had a dead iPhone or a dead Android? You plug it in for 5 minutes and it doesn't turn on, it doesn't work. Your phone is so dead, just wait. I tried not being angry today, it didn't work, Nisan sucks. Wait. Abyssal Gadol, a bit of patience. Plug in, take a few breaths, and go for the next 28 days. And see if you can overcome a particular self-challenge. Something that you struggle with. Don't try to fix other people in this month. That's not the energy of Nisan, by the way. Fix yourself. There are other months for helping others. Plenty of other months. This is fix yourself. Exit your own confines. Be the free person. Don't be a slave. The only slavery is when we're a slave to ourselves. And that's not a cliche. That is the very, very teachings of all of Jewish spirituality. That was 3 weeks. We're going to stop for Pesach. And then we'll restart in a few weeks from now. I'm hoping that the last few weeks has been a hybrid of both entertainment as well as a good lesson. If the Kabbalists and the mystics chose to write about it, it's because it's achievable. If they wrote about it, it's because the people like us need to know about it. And if we need to know about it, it's because it's within our capacity to enact and achieve. I agree with everyone, it's too hard. But every time you feel that, just walk into the bathroom and look in the mirror and remind yourself, you're not the lion, you're not a zebra. You are from the supreme species called humanity. And humanity has a lot of gifts and a lot of talents. But as anyone with a talent and gift knows, it doesn't mean it's easy. It just means it's easier. And with that, I want to... easier than for other people. But with that, I want to wish everyone a good Yom Tov. If you would like to join us for the second night of Pesach, we have a Seder here, which I'll be leading, of which we'll explore some Kabbalistic ideas on the Haggadah and just celebrate as a community and as a big family. And I really look forward to seeing you after Yom Tov if I don't see you before. Chag Sameach.
Thank you.